Anglo-Indians, once the sahibs of Dhiraj, are today struggling to keep alive their identity. Why did their fortunes take a downturn in less than a century after independence? I'm Dhiraj Singh, and in my quest to find out why cultures such as those of the Anglo-Indians flourish or vanish, I'm heading to the eastern Indian state of Jharkhand. Hidden in the lush green forests of the Chota Nagpur Plateau, about 50 kilometers from the Jharkhand capital of Ranchi, lies a peculiar settlement. The land for building this township was leased out by the former Maharaja of Ratu. The onward road passes through dense forest land, an area that is said to harbor Maoist insurgents. But we are told traveling in broad daylight is usually not a problem. Passing through the rich greenery of the plateau, I am struck by the notion that an Anglo-Indian settlement could be found in a place so far removed from the cities. This is in stark contrast to the image of Anglo-Indians, whom I knew as strictly English-speaking people who lived mostly in the cities. In the days of the Raj, Anglo-Indians became almost synonymous with the railways, as it was one of their biggest employers, mostly because they spoke good English. While definitions of who can or cannot be called an Anglo-Indian vary, there is broad consensus that the term Anglo-Indian is loosely used for descendants of British and Indian parents. A long drive from Ranchi comes to a fork in the road, where a long and lavish signboard points to our destination. We are told that McCluskie's Ganj is another 6 to 8 kilometers from this point. And then we start seeing the signs. Glimpses of red tiled roofs surrounded by acres and acres of green forest. As an idea, McCluskie's Ganj started as a resettlement plan inside the head of one E.T. McCluskie. A real estate man, McCluskie wanted to give a permanent home to the country's Anglo-Indians. It was the 1930s and the Quit India movement was still a decade away. However, the freedom struggle had already created a deep suspicion in the minds of many Indians about the loyalty of the Anglo-Indian community. This, in a way, created a sense of insecurity in the minds of those Anglo-Indians who saw their idea of a golden age coming to an end. Writer Sadat Hasan Manto, in his story Toba Tek Singh, hints at this insecurity, where the Anglo-Indian inmates of a mental hospital wonder whether they would have to make do with chapatis instead of bread and butter under the new dispensation. So, was this place, selected for its natural beauty and climate, merely a place to insulate Anglo-Indians from the onslaught of a chapati culture? Or was it supposed to be a place that Anglos from all over India could truly call home? Kitty Teixeira has seen the Ganj change for over five decades. Born in the 50s in McCluskie Ganj, Kitty's maternal grandfather lost all his saving in E.T. McCluskie's Colonization Society of India, the company in whose shares many of the early settlers had invested.
He wanted to make it a mini England, and that's what happened. But the society, Colonization Society, did very bad with the settlers here. Amalgamated, and all their money was lost on shares. My grandfather lost 40,000 on the shares.
Kitty is today a sort of mascot of McCluskie Ganj's journey. From a unique address to the reversal of its fortunes. The fact that Kitty has been featured in several articles and books on McCluskie Ganj is a big part of her appeal for outsiders. Perhaps because Kitty's story runs contrary to the image of an educated and well-off Anglo-Indian community.
Thoda sa tamatar, thoda sa bhindi, thoda sa bodhi, faras bean, khira.
Because her family lost its savings, she started selling fruit when most Anglo-Indian girls her age were getting educated. How old were you when you started?
9.
Okay.
9 years old. Then I started bringing the fruits to the station and selling. At the age of 16 and 17, I used to go out with fruits like Kalari side and all. And when the passenger steam engine was on the line, we used to get good sale at the station only. We didn't no need to go out anywhere. Mm-hmm. But when the diesel engine came in, our sales went fat. Then we had to go out to sell. Mm. And then after that, the electric engine came. Mm. Then we used to go out to sell. Then the hostels came and then we started selling in the hostels.
But now, because of the hard work involved in selling fruit, Kitty's daily trips to the railway station have ceased. Today, Kitty Mem Saab is hard up for money. So much so that she has to sign up for the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act's daily wage scheme. Bad times in a way have followed Kitty since she was small. When she was younger, she married a local boy because he was sympathetic to her struggles. But the years of family happiness too didn't stay for long.
Neither can he talk nor can he walk. Problem is, he had a fight with somebody and he was beaten up very badly and his hands were twisted, legs were twisted and all by that fella. And then we had to take him to hospital. He was 15 days in hospital. And then they said partial paralysis, as well as due to this bleeding, mm-hmm. blood clots in the head. There were three places, there were big blood clots. Mm. After the injury.
This now decrepit bungalow was once the home of one Stanley Oswald Porter. The Porters came to settle here from Mysore. Their story is told to us by the Paswans, to whom Stanley Porter, a bachelor, became a father figure.
Ji wo to bahut acha the, kabhi kisi se jhoot nahi bolte the. Agar dukaan agar koi servant ko bhejte the, तो वहाँ से अगर गलती से अगर दुकानदार मतलब कि चार आना भी अगर चवन्नी भी अगर हिसाब में बेसिक भेज देते थे तो उसको फिर वो बोलते कि इसको रिटर्न कर दो या तो फिर सर्वेंट लोग को मार देते थे. बच्चों से बहुत प्यार करते थे और बच्चा लोग को हमेशा मानते रहते थे. कोई भी कुछ किसी तरह का अगर दुख मुसीबत बताता तो हमेशा तो मदद कर देते. कभी मतलब उनको दुख किसी का देख के बर्दाश्त नहीं होता था.
In these albums is perhaps captured the history of the Anglo-Indian community, one that was uniquely at peace with its two very distinct cultural identities. Where on the one hand the album is full of formal family portraits, bada khanas and tambola parties, there are also pictures that speak of the Porters' involvement in the building of independent India.
पहले तो महीना दो महीना में मतलब हमेशा
शादी के बाद यहाँ पे
जी
93
फोटो कौन लेता था, ये सब फोटो किसने लिए?
यहाँ का पर्यावरण पहले अच्छा था, और मतलब यहाँ पर मतलब कि अंग्रेज लोग पहले रहते थे, तो सोचा कि हम यहीं पर जा करके बसें। यहाँ तो बहुत उसमें बहुत बहुत सारे लोग थे।
क्या काम करते थे वो, व्यवसाय क्या था?
गवर्नर का पर्सनल असिस्टेंट थे, डॉक्टर जाकिर हुसैन के साथ मतलब बहुत दिन रहे।
Noel Gordon is perhaps the last of the first settlers of the Ganj, as McCluskie Ganj was fondly known among its residents. His family came from Calcutta, where his father worked for one of the thriving jute mills there.
I used to do repairs of electronics, but that was habit. And then a jute mill life is a life that Abita Bachchan also perhaps is not getting that in Bombay.
But then Noel's father heard about McCluskie's mini England coming up in the salubrious jungles of Ranchi, a place not very far from Calcutta. And then life took a turn. That seemed like a very good idea in those days.
Dad, he settled here in 1958, fag end of 58. Well, those days we still had a lot of Anglo-Indians. And when we first came here, the train used to come here at about, from Barkakhana, it used to come here at about 4:30, 5 o'clock. When I was slightly old, I mean, say I was 8, 9 years old, we had a post office somewhere on the way. And we could only see Anglo-Indians, many of them. We hardly saw anyone with dhotis and all that.
Today, Gordon and his son run what is perhaps McCluskie Ganj's only guest house. It is specially useful for members of old settler families who left the Ganj for greener pastures. Many now come to visit their old bungalows and the McCluskie Ganj graveyard, where they can locate old family graves and perhaps piece together a better picture of their family trees. The graveyard itself tells the story of the decline of E.T. McCluskie's idea. Where the older part of the graveyard is full of stone and marble graves, many of the newer burials are practically unmarked, or what are called kacha graves. But the story of McCluskie Ganj wasn't always so depressing. It was a town that provided for all the tastes and sometimes the idiosyncrasies of the average Anglo-Indian.
We were not really connected to the rest of the world, but, you know, life was absolutely different. Once upon a time, there were bakery run by the Anglo-Indians, slaughterhouse run by the Anglo-Indians, mochis, cobblers by the Anglo-Indians, and gramophone stores run by the Anglo-Indians. So, and I'd like to tell you one thing. McCluskie Ganj was more advanced than Ranchi. We could get more things here. We used to get some other people coming over here, visiting us, visiting McCluskie. We had some department stores over here. And you could get some cosmetics, some good cloth, like China silk and all that, which was not available in Ranchi.
Another old-timer from the early days is John Mendes. John remembers the Ganj as a place that was full of fun and good times.
As a small boy, it was a nice place, quiet and lonely and jungle place. There was too much jungle, animals, very few people. Mostly there were Anglo-Indians here. And school days and all, I was here in the Ganj. It was very quiet and compared to now. Well, we had the old club, we had the old people here, and one or two olden days vehicles used to run, like these motorcycles we didn't have, but the vehicles we had here were all like spokes. Austins and Faustins and all, you know, olden days. And it was a quiet place. We didn't have cycles also those days. Wherever we had to go, we had to walk it. Or go by bullock cart.
But there was only one problem. There were no jobs in McCluskie Ganj. So people had to go out in search of work.
You see, when you come to a place and you think and you want to build, you want to go for the future. But then when you find there's no future, everything is against the wall. There's no proper medical year, there's no sort of anything you can back on. So people started losing heart and interest, so they started packing up.
Many left the Ganj in search of greener pastures. However, this weekly market continues to attract large numbers of vendors and buyers who add colour to this fast-fading town. Though little is known about E.T. McCluskie, his ambitious resettlement plan is today survived by this plaque. While it is largely agreed that it was the climate that gave it the epithet Chota England or Mini England, there was another aspect that made McCluskie Ganj quite the place for adventure seekers.
They came here because what I feel they had come here to hunt. Because most of the houses are built in the interior parts of the jungle. And this place was popularly known for wild boars.
However, the idea of an idyllic home started to wear thin in the years following its setting up. It was these years of painful transition from British India to one that no more saw the Anglo-Indians as a privileged elite that many residents of McCluskie Ganj decided to leave for the UK, Canada and Australia. Many people just packed their bags, sold their bungalows and left in search of a better life. Vikas Jha, a journalist from Patna, came to McCluskie Ganj for a newspaper story, but got hooked on to the idea of this very unique settlement. Over the years, his affair with the Ganj has produced a novel that is set in a fictional McCluskie Ganj, but is heavily inspired by the real thing.
Anglo-Indians are sahibs. And when we compare Anglo-Indians with Parsis, with Jews, there's a lot of difference. Parsis in Jamshedpur, they did hard labor to establish themselves. But, sorry to say, that Anglo-Indian community never liked to touch the soil for agriculture. They said, "Tab to when we will do this like labor, like a farmer, we will be called Indian Mazdoor."
But for the Anglos of the Ganj, life took a turn for the better when a Don Bosco Academy opened a branch here. Today, the school has become a huge employment generator for the locals, as hostels run by them for the school's children have mushroomed since its opening. Signboards advertising hostels can be found in every nook and corner of the Ganj today.
We began the school in 1997, April 7th. It's a branch of Don Bosco Academy, Patna. It's run by Anglo-Indian Society. And the founder, principal and the director of the school is Mr. Alfred George de Rosario, who was then MLC of Undivided Bihar. And when he visited this place as MLC of McCluskie, since it's being an Anglo-Indian town, the people of the residents over here, they requested Mr. Rosario to do something for this place also. So then he thought about beginning a school in McCluskie Ganj. We wanted to have hostel facilities because we know hardly the number of students from this locality will be very less only. We had to cater students from outside only. We expected students to come from outside. At the same time, we did not want to have our own hostel, as if we have our own hostel, completely residential school, then all-round development of McCluskie's will not be possible. That was the idea of Mr. Rosario. He decided the school will not run the hostel. Instead, it will be run by the Anglo-Indian families in the beginning, and later on, if the need arises, then we will give permission to the other residents of McCluskie's.
With the coming of hostels like these, McCluskie's has once again become a place where the laughter and cheer of the next generation is being heard loud and clear. Although not all of the children studying at the school are from here, it has stopped the tide of younger people moving out for things as basic as schooling. Most of the hostels are run by old Anglo-Indian families. This is seen by parents as a bonus, as it provides an English-speaking atmosphere outside the school.
This place is a quiet place, and people, there's no interfering with studies. So if anyone wants to come study from outside, they like the place, quiet place for studies place. And there are quite a number of hostels who are doing well in Ganj. So hostel business works in a family actually. So husband, wife there is, so mother, sons or daughters, all in a family, it helps around. There are servants to see to the children, look after the children, but it is in the family.
The old romance of the place may not have come back fully, but there are people like Malcolm Hurrican who can never think of leaving the Ganj. Malcolm has recently begun a blog about McCluskie Ganj, where he posts pictures and write-ups about the goings-on of his town.
I said the best is to let people know about McCluskie Ganj, because tourist center, McCluskie Ganj, is going to go to dogs in the form of any historical evidence that was here. All is going to be wiped out slowly. People are buying the bungalows, dropping them down, rebuilding them, modifying them. So McCluskie Ganj will be lost altogether. You've seen the picture of the graveyard. I've put some pictures of the graveyard cemetery. Now that shows, it has evidence that people died here in 1930s, 32, 33. That means they lived here to die here. But soon there'll be nothing left. So the more popular this place gets, the government will take action maybe to protect that, and that was the idea basically.
Malcolm feels there's much in the place that can be of interest to people outside.
I want them to come and just visit and to even buy property and try and bring back that old culture that was here. We want people like that. We just don't want people investing money and building flats and apartments and things like that. We want people actually who come and mix with the Anglo-Indians. In fact, we want more Anglo-Indians to come and settle down here, which is not looking possible now, because the land that was easily available first, now it's not available at all.
This sentiment is shared by Glenn Galston, the Anglo-Indian MLA of the Jharkhand Assembly. Sitting here at what is probably the Ganj's oldest building, he says the place would be better served if it gets more visitors. As more and more people realize the contribution of Anglo-Indians to the making of modern India.
We are more Indian than Anglo, so it was very easy for us to get in there. We've been born and brought up in the Indian society, and we have taken from the Indian society a lot, we've learnt a lot, adapted ourselves, and I think vice versa. The other side also, they've taken a lot from us, where the language is concerned. Before, the English language was only thought to be the language, mother tongue of the Anglo-Indians. But today you find everybody speaking in English, and they speak the accent that an Anglo-Indian speaks. So the eating habits, clothes, etc., everything is Indian. So we didn't have any problem as such.
It's not surprising that the uniqueness of the place is more apparent to outsiders, because only they can see what is probably accepted as second nature by the locals. Prembari, built by a Delhi businessman in the 80s, is a temple and dargah complex. And today, it stands as a silent testimony to the idea of unity in diversity. It is said that he also intended to build a small Christian shrine and a gurudwara at the complex, but somehow he could not. However, his unfinished dream has in a way captured the spirit of McCluskie Ganj. The Anglo-Indian settlement may be on the verge of extinction, but the pace of life in McCluskie Ganj continues. With that, we've come to the end of our story on McCluskie Ganj. But hope continues to live in the hearts and minds of McCluskieites, for whom there is no better place on earth than this. We hope you liked our presentation. This is Dhiraj Singh with his entire team saying thanks for watching and goodbye.